kids, you are dismissed. If you have a child all the way up to fifth grade, you can go with Ms. Taylor. You're free to release the kids.
Can you hear me? All right. Again, my name is Kelly Chestnut, and this is Terry Cullins, and we are with Education First Home Stay Program. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the program before we get started. Education First is a non-Christian based company. They do not care where we place our students. So when Terry and I was, let me tell you a little bit about myself and then I'll tell you a little bit about Terry. I did a Daniel fast about 2 years ago and I said, okay, Lord, I am, you know, getting older, I have children that are growing up, what more do you have for me besides just my family and my children? I served him for years and years, but what more? About a week after the Daniel fast, this program came to me and I didn't know anything about it. And I said, okay, Lord, if this is what you have as my mission, then I am only going to place them in Christian homes. With your help and with your guidance, you will open the door for me into churches that I've never been to before, people I've never seen before, their doors will be open for me. And so that has happened for the past 3 years now. And after I got into the program, about 3 weeks later, Terry and I were introduced. And she is also a Christian and a strong prayer warrior and one of my best friends now. And we ended up only living like, 5 minutes from each other. And out of all of Lakeland. And so we have just combined together to fill our programs and work together. And so we're in no competition with each other. We have programs that are exactly the same, just different dates. So this is what the deal is. So when you're in your bulletin, you saw some dates. Those were from my program. Thank the Lord. My program is completely full. I have all my families, all Christian families. So now we're going to focus on Terry's program. Terry's program still needs one course leader, which is the adult who's coming, and 10 students to be placed. Most of the students that she has and needs placement for are for boy homes. So we're just trying to find homes that could accommodate a boy or two. Anyway, so let me tell you a little bit about the children. Their ages are 9 to 13. They are babies. I mean, can you imagine putting your 9-year-old on a plane, sending them across the world to be in a home that they don't know? Neither can I. But these children come. In China, it's a huge deal to say that your child has traveled internationally. These children study every day from about 7:30, 8 o'clock till 5:30, 6 o'clock at night, 6 days a week. In the nighttime, they are doing tutoring, they're doing music, they're doing all kinds of stuff, and on Sunday, the same thing. If they don't go to worship, they are in tutoring. Education First over there is a big English program, and this is an extra on top of their schoolwork program that their families pay for. So these children do not understand what downtime is. They don't know how to play the Wii. They do not, and I know, and it comes from China, right? Okay, but they do not know how to play the Wii. They do not, they've never cooked. They've never cracked an egg. They've never baked cookies. So when you bring them over to your home and you make cookies with them and you make cupcakes and decorate them, they're like thrilled. The boys too, I'm telling you, the boys too love cooking. They've never been fishing. They've never been out on a boat. I mean, things we take for granted. A lot of them don't know how to swim, but they love swimming. A lot of them don't know how to swim. So thinking that through, it's like they're over here for education and conversational English, okay? And they're here to experience our culture. Well, what is our culture? Hello, this is our culture. This is what we do, okay? It is okay that we bring them to church. They don't care that we bring them to church. So every year with my families and that kind of, and we have been able to provide them Chinese Bibles, a full Chinese Bible from Genesis to Revelation. They can carry this back into China. We can't send it. This is called Western religion. So they can carry it back in because they're all about education, remember? So we do a Chinese Bible, and I mean real Chinese, like And they ended up carrying it in. So the reason we do Chinese Bibles is so that if they lay it down, their families don't want it, whatever, somebody else can pick it up and read it. If we send it in English, not everybody can read English, but everybody can read Chinese. Let me tell you a few little stories. The first year we had this one boy, he was older, he was one of my oldest ones, and he was staunch, he was tough. And he's like, I don't like church, I don't like church, I not go to church. And he crossed his arms. I was like, I'm ready, but you're over here to experience what we do. So come on, we're going to church. So we brought him to church and he sat there like this the whole time. And so I'm thinking, okay, Lord. And so we ended up connecting with a Chinese pastor over in Tampa. And he is one of the chaplains for USF for the Chinese students who come over. And he came over and he gave them a clear plan of salvation in Mandarin. And so we try to do that every year. It's not a guarantee we get to do that. It depends on his schedule, but we try every year. So we get in back in the car and Kobe, they get to choose their own English name. So Kobe, he's in the car and he's like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And I'm like, what? And the course leader was with me. I'm like, Iris, what's going on? And she's like, and he takes his translator and he swings it around in my face and he said, brainwashing. And I said, oh, no, Kobe, a gift. He's like, I'm too young. I go, what are you too young for a gift? I said, do you tell your parents I'm too young for a gift? No, you accept the gift. But in America, you can take or leave, just a gift. So he ended up sitting next to me in church, and I turned over to John 3:16, and I pointed to it, and I said, the gift. And they can read English sometimes better than they can speak, so he read. And so when the Chinese pastor provided the Bibles for us, I wrapped the Bibles, and I handed it to him. And I said, Kobe, your gift. And he opened it up, and he said, Teacher Kelly, I will read, and I will learn what is the gift. Or what is the truth? And I said, you will learn that the gift is the truth. Now, in the light of eternity, do I know if Colby accepted Christ? No. I am called to sow seeds. That is what God calls us to do, is to plant the seed. He will reap in time. But think about this. What if Colby goes in the military and goes into an underground church? Because China has the most per capita Christians than the United States does. Underground churches are everywhere. I said, what if Colby gets in the military, never accepts Christ, but walks into an underground church to destroy those people and those missionaries, and doesn't, for the love that we showed him, the time we showed him, the gift we showed him, in just the 16 days he was here? Is that important to you? It's important to me. It's important to Christ. You know, that's what you got to understand. These 16 days are much more valuable than just, you got a Chinese student, you're planting into their hearts and into their souls much more than just culture, than just English. You're planting Christ. I mean, I know that quite a few of you are going on a missions trip. Now you get the missions trip home, but you get that one-on-one time with that student. We still email our students from 2 years ago. Our little guy from last year, his name was Henry. I want to tell you Henry's story. Henry came over, and just this most precious little kid, I tell you, he was amazing. And he comes to me and he says, Mom, because they will call you Mom and Dad by the time it's over. It's Mom, and it's M-U-M, just so y'all know. He's like, Mom, he says, tell me the American stories. And I'm like, American stories? He's like, yeah, tell me the American stories that the Americans know. And I was like, are you talking out of the Bible? He says, yes. My teacher and my mom said for me to learn all the stories. So I went and I got him his Bible. Now, I still have his Bible, and I'll tell you why. He took it upstairs, and my son, Josiah, they went upstairs, and they started reading at night. We had devotions, but they would go up and read at night all the stories. And Josiah had his Bible and was reading English. Henry would read in Chinese. And they would read and read and read until 2 and 3 in the morning. They'd come down the next morning. They're like this. And I'm like, what's wrong? They go, we've been reading all night, you know. So they were able to just read everything that they could think of, you know. And so anyway, so Henry kept his Bible with him. From the minute I gave it to him, he put it in his backpack and he kept it with him.
The reason I have this is because we went to the beach and he put his wet towel as a, you know, 11-year-old Will in his backpack and it warped his Bible. He comes downstairs almost in tears going, Mom, look, it's no good. And I go, Henry, it is good. He goes, no, I want you. I want good going home. And I went and I had another Bible and I handed it to him and he went, gold. Now let me tell you a little bit about God orchestrating all that. Last year was the first year that I had families that hosted from First Baptist Church of the Mall. Never had a family from there, and it's just like this. The Nichols family are hosting this year with my group. I met them through a homeschooling group. You just don't know how God is going to orchestrate all the details. I'm here because of them. This family ended up hosting a student. Come to find out that First Baptist Church at the Mall has a church plant in Chengdu. Where was Henry from? Chengdu. Only God can orchestrate those details. You know, I don't know what God has in store for us this year. Terry's group is from Shanghai, correct? I don't know what's in Shanghai that's for you. My group is from Beijing. I don't know what's from Beijing that's for us this year. But all we do is open the door and have an opportunity to minister to these kids. These kids are here again from July 10th through July 26th. Now your program says the 9th through the 28th, that's when we have them. We have them a little bit before and a little bit after. We take them to Disney, we take them to Universal, that's what the company in their package that they provide. So the families don't have to do that. You provide the student three meals a day, breakfast, lunch, and supper. They go to the course center, which Terry's course center is Fellowship Baptist Church off of Cleveland Heights. So pretty close to here. And you drop them off at 8:00 in the morning and you pick them up at 5:30 in the afternoon. They're with us during those times and they do schoolwork some, and then they also go on field trips. Now, we also invite the families to go with us if they want to experience the whole group and those kind of things. But you don't have to if you work. That's why it's been provided so that those who work can't go, oh, but I work. Well, we've kind of taken care of that one for you. They can stay in the room with your children, but they can't, they have to have their own bed. So like for my boys, we have twin beds. So we put an air mattress on the floor. One of my boys sleeps on the air mattress. The Chinese student sleeps in the bed. All three of the boys are in the same room. Okay, we provide a little bit of dresser space, closet space. That's what happens. You know, last year I ended up hosting three students due to the fact that there were some complications with some of the families, which was okay. Just kept bringing them into the house. And so my boys ended up sleeping on the couch and it was just like a big like camp at the house. So, and I actually took pictures of making lunch. Like I'd never seen that much bread on my counter. But food is a really neat thing. They like chicken and they like bacon. Bacon probably is the biggest thing. They like our milk. Milk is so poor over there that when they get over here and they can drink whole milk, they are so thrilled. Yogurt, those kind of things, orange juice. It's very simple, the food. We thought that it would be more complicated. It's not. I bought ramen noodles, never used them. Never ever used them. So they didn't want my ramen noodles. How about that? But they love church's fried chicken. Anyway, so the thing about it is it's these kids, it's a simple thing. What they're not used to is unconditional love. They come pulling up in that bus with Terry or myself, and y'all are standing out there with signs, welcoming them, excited. We have a welcome party. They're not used to just being loved because they're them. They're only used to being loved by what they do. Yeah. And so in that, we provide this unconditional love. And I truly believe that it's even more in our programs because we seek out Christian homes and we get the unconditional love bestowed upon these children because we get it from Christ. And that love is just so translated into these children that when they leave in just that 16 days, they are sobbing. The sobs on those buses are heart-wrenching. I get to go from, or Terry gets to go from here to Disney as they're just crying and crying. I can't even explain how hard it is. They're not, I mean, yes, they're going to Disney, but that's not the sound that I always have heard going to Disney. I mean, they are so sad. They don't want to leave America. Do they love their moms and dads at home? Absolutely. But we show them something that they've never, ever had before. Is it worth it to you for 16 days? That's the thing that we have to consider. You know, I know it takes us out of our comfort zone a little bit to put somebody in our home or to rearrange the bedding situation or something like that. But I'm going to tell you what. I know it's for these students, but the joy, the fullness that you have. I told my husband after the 3 weeks the first year, I was so exhausted because we were going to call 24/7. I mean, 3 o'clock in the morning, if the child's sick, you call us. But we're on call 24/7. At the end of that, we are so exhausted, but full. I've never been so more spiritually full at the end of the program than I was then. And every year it's been the same. I keep going on these little rabbit trails. If you have a high school student, the high school student gets 45 community service hours for hosting. That's just a bonus and a benefit. It's not the most important thing, but I know it is. It adds a little thing for the students. But what I look at is like my boys. What is it going to do for them in the light of eternity? My own personal boys for missions. How's it going to make them feel and think about that kid who's walking down the street or is on their soccer team? Not just a little person anymore. They're a soul. And you pour into your own kids that way. Do you have anything?
Okay. Hi, I'm Terry. I definitely want to thank you guys for inviting. The Holy Spirit is here, man. I was just like, I'm surprised I'm not, you know. I was ugly crying earlier, but God is here. And I really want you guys, you know, we don't want to beg anybody. If it's in your heart, you know, really, really pray about it and seek if it's God, you know, your will to host. But seriously, these kids do love their host families, and it is a life-changing experience. And it is only 16 days, and you know, we love for you guys to get involved. And I'll be here. My number is on the little pink sheet. If you didn't get a pink sheet, I'm happy to give you one. July 10th to the 26th, 16 days, and you can change a life. But you can also change your family because you guys are going to be like, this is so awesome. Do you want to show them the video?
Yep, we can show the video.
Kelly made a video, and it really shows from 2 years ago? Last year. Okay, look and see how amazing, what an amazing time, and look and see what you can do for God in this program.
The message we by the passion of the flame, spewing light unsparingly throughout a darkened room. Let us burn to know him deeper, let us serve us flaming bright.
Let's give Chris a thank you, Jeremiah. It's so good to see all of you too. Well, I'm just going to tell a little bit about where I've come from and how I got here. I grew up in Metro Detroit, which is not around here. And I was given a prophetic word in about fifth grade. I was going to a Christian school and was told, you're going to be a worship leader someday. And I'm like, cool. So I guess I should join band or something. So that's what I did. I played around musically at home with like a keyboard, you know, before that, but no formal music training before that. So I went into band and then choir, and which led me to come to Southeastern here in Lakeland. And that was, all leading up through middle school to high school. And in high school, we moved to Central Michigan, which was definitely out of my comfort zone. The Lord kind of took me out of my comfort zone there. They say you can take the boy out of the city, but you can't take the city out of the boy. And that's me. So came to Southeastern and graduated with a degree in music education. And during that time, the Lord spoke to me and he said, what if I told you to stay here? And I didn't even want to think about that because I was like, oh, I'm going to go back up to Michigan. I'm going to teach in schools. I'm going to be a worship leader on the side, you know, all this stuff. And so I didn't think about that for a year. And that thought kept haunting me and haunting me. And I was like, you know, I guess I should give it some thought. And then it was confirmed in a lot of different ways, and I was just like, okay, God, I'm just going to give up my own plans. I'm going to trust in what you have to say. So, again, taking me out of my comfort zone.
Another thing that happened during that time at Southeastern between 2005 and 2010 is the Lord kind of took me from playing as a background player or a backup singer to being somebody who led worship. That was definitely out of my comfort zone. I'm a natural bass. And so lots of Christian music are not written by bass singers. They're written by tenors who sing very high. You know, so that was out of my comfort zone. But you know, the Lord encouraged me and sent people to encourage me. And so once again, stepping out of my comfort zone, I was working at United Church as the media director from 2005 until July 2011. And it was a very comfortable position. I had about 100 different volunteers underneath me and within about 3 years. So it was fun, it was great, you know, but the Lord told me, you know, I need you to step out and help start the House of Prayer. And I'm like, I don't know a lot about the House of Prayer. So I stepped out in July 2011 and helped start the House of Prayer in faith, and that was definitely out of my comfort zone. A lot of things changed. Shortly after, the Lord led me here to Heart of the Father, where I received, and I'm still receiving, a lot of healing and just restoration, and really have felt the love and the acceptance here. So thank you all. At the end of last year, our directors from the House of Prayer moved back up north to Pennsylvania. So I'm actually now directing the House of Prayer, and it's definitely out of my comfort zone. But finding the Lord being faithful to lead me into things that I'm not necessarily qualified for, but He calls me into. I just wanted to share that with you, because you may be on a journey yourself where you feel that you're not qualified. You may feel that you don't necessarily look like the poster, you know, guy or poster girl for whatever the Lord has called you to. But don't be afraid and don't be ashamed of that call, because it's what He's going to equip you for if you trust Him. Just lean into Him, trust Him. You know, now I'm leading the House of Prayer, doing the Redwood Life, which is sort of like small groups to teach the core values of the House of Prayer, and directing Bound for Life as well, which some of you, actually a lot of you, have been to, and we have coming up at the, actually 2 Saturdays from now. So the first weekend in May. So that's a bit of who I am and where I've come from, what I'm doing now. So thank you.
Yeah, we bless Chris and what the Lord is doing through him at Heart of the Father. And Chris is just kind of a jack of all trades. He does a lot. He shoots the prophetic videos that I do. He does the church website. He just does a bunch of different things. And Chris, we have Bound for Life the first Saturday of every month, where we stand at the Lakeland Abortion Clinic here, the Women's Health Center, and Chris is faithfully out there and getting the Lakeland House of Prayer going, and they're having meetings. If that's something that you would like to get more involved in and know more about, we bless Chris and what the Lord is calling him to do. Thank you for sharing. Alex, come on up. Woo. Alex is a lot. Let's give Alex a round of applause. I have a feeling that we have someone else that God might be calling out of their comfort zone.
Yes, in fact, exactly what you shared is one of the things that I'm going to talk about, that God has been dealing with me a lot, especially this past week. So my name is Alex. I'm a senior at Southeastern, and I graduate in 13 days, 7 hours, and 15 minutes. I'm so excited. And I graduate with a degree in English and Intercultural Studies, which sounds like 2 degrees, but it's just one. And I'm going to be a missionary. So I'm going to talk a little bit about my history, my testimony in missions, and then what's the next step for me. And it's very exciting. So my testimony in missions, I wasn't going to be a missionary when I started college. When I started college, I was going to be a film director. I was going to be the most famous film director there ever was, and I was going to serve God through film. I actually was planning, I was at a different school, in Ohio, and I was studying broadcasting. I was involved in theater. I did all that kind of stuff, and I loved it. It was fun. But the problem was I was really searching for a way to be known, to be famous and recognized. And recognized for what I could do and what I could bring to the plate and say, this is me and this is my gift and my talent and I serve God because of what I can do. And that's not what God's looking for. And after 1 year at that school in Ohio, I transferred to Southeastern. And you would think that that's when my life changed and turned around, but actually, I transferred in as a music major. And I was like, now I'm going to be the world's most famous worship leader. And I'm going to lead worship for a huge church. And I'm going to have the American dream on the side. I'm going to have a huge house and a car, two kids and a dog. And that was going to be my life. And a year went by at Southeastern. So my sophomore year was over. And it was summer. My family, you probably have known my family. Andrew and I Grace and my parents, and they were living in Indiana at the time. They weren't living in Lakeland. And I went back to Indiana that summer, and I was, remember, I'm a music major, and that was my life. And my mom says, Alex, you need to get your two-year plan together so we know what your two-year plan is. So I went up to my room, and I was getting my two-year plan together, and I was looking at oral theory, too, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is going to be terrible. Oral theory is a terrible class, in case you're wondering. For musicians, it's just, oh, it's terrible. Anyway, I was like, oh great, I'm going to have to do oral theory and all this stuff, and for some reason, I was just like, maybe I should look at a different degree. I don't know why. I don't have a logical reason for doing this, but I looked at English and Intercultural Studies, which my mom was currently interviewing to be the director of at Southeastern, so I just thought I'd look at it, and I was like, let's see what you could do with this degree. And it turns out you can be a missionary with this degree. And I thought, well, I don't really want to be a missionary. But for some reason, I came downstairs and I said, guys, I'm going to be a missionary. I came up as a musician and I came down a missionary. And I, to this day, I don't have a logical reason for doing that in my head. And I'll come back to it later and tell you exactly what that was about. But at that time, I was like, I don't know why I'm doing this. And this was my junior year, right? Switching degrees in my junior year is not a good idea. I'm telling you, it's terrible. I've had to take 20 credit hours every semester since then to get this degree done. So that's not really a good idea. But it was God's idea. So that next semester, I started taking missions classes with Dr. Houlihan, and he blew my mind, the kinds of stuff that missionaries did. And we don't hear about all the missionaries that are out there. We hear about a few. And maybe the ones that are at our church, or maybe a few that our family support. But all the missionaries out there, I mean, I've heard stories of missionaries that no one knows about, but what they're doing is incredible. And I was just, my mind was like, oh, I want to do that. And this is my thought process. I'm going to be the most famous missionary there ever was. That's what I was going to do, right? And then I got involved in this documentary at Southeastern. They had advertised it as a documentary to a restricted country. And I was at this point, I was like, I'm gonna go do something dangerous. And when I do that dangerous thing, God's gonna do something big, and then the whole world's gonna know about it. And my name's gonna be in big lights and everything as someone that survived this huge, big, scary thing in this restricted country. And so I signed up to go on this trip. And then I got accepted to go. There was an interview process. I got accepted to go to be the writer for this documentary. And then they switched it. We were going to this completely 100% Muslim nation where missionaries were not allowed to be. And Tori Rasmussen that we support here, he was the one leading the trip. Well, I'm not sure of all the details, but if you know Tori, you'll understand. He somehow had a conflict in this country and decided, it's too dangerous to go there, we're not going to go anymore. So we changed it. He was going to Tanzania instead. And my first thought was, that sounds so boring. I don't want to go to Tanzania. I don't want to go. And it took me a while to kind of get over this, I don't know if I want to go anymore. I really feel like if this trip had been advertised as going to Tanzania, I never would have signed up for it. I'm positive that that's true. But I was driving to work about a week after we switched from this country to Tanzania, and I was in the car, and every time I'm in the car, I talk to God out loud. And I was telling him, I don't know where I'm supposed to be. Where am I supposed to be a missionary? You haven't made that clear to me yet. Everyone else in the missions department has a place that they're going. I don't know where I'm going. I feel so completely overwhelmed and out in the middle of the water, and I don't know what I'm doing. And I shook my fist in the air, because that's what I do. I stopped at a stoplight, and I was like, just tell me where I'm supposed to be. And then I look at the car in front of me, and this story, this is what I hold on to when I'm questioning myself. I looked at the car in front of me, and it has a bumper sticker. I don't remember what the car looks like, but I remember this bumper sticker, and it's just a flag, and it says Tanzania underneath it. And I was just like, that's not, there's no way. I only heard about Tanzania a week ago. That would have meant nothing to me a week ago. But right now, and I just remember thinking, okay, I don't want to go, but that sounds pretty awesome to me. And ever since then, this passion started building in me. Oh, Tanzania, this is going to be great. I can't wait to go to this country and experience Tanzania. And while we were in Tanzania, we had this one night. We went to this tribe called the Wajir tribe, which I'm telling you guys, I love these people so much, this tribe. It makes me get emotional. But we spent this night in prayer for this tribe, and the Holy Spirit was so thick in that truck. We were crammed in this truck because if we were outside, all the Wajir people would be all in our faces wanting to know what we were doing. So we were trying to be in this truck to have our own prayer time, and it was just like, it was so thick and heavy, and I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, it was like tangible. Like so tangible, like fragrant, and it was incredible, and it was so heavy. I was so bowed down with intercession for this tribe, and at the end, Tori told a story about how the last time he was with the Wajir, he went out to the river, it was dry, and he got down on his face and he prayed. He said, God, send a missionary to this tribe, and he told me when he prayed for a missionary, and it was the same time that I changed from a musician to a missionary. It was the same week that he prayed for God to send a missionary that I changed. So I didn't have a logical reason, but God had a reason and he had a way. So to me, that was just like, okay, now I know this is where I'm supposed to be. I know this is what I'm supposed to do. And even then, you guys, I struggled with this, wanting to be known, wanting to be recognized and famous for something. It's been a huge struggle. And this last year, this is kind of where I'm going next in missions. I got back from Tanzania thinking I have to go back. I don't know how I'm going to go back, but I have to. I love this tribe. I love what I'm doing. The documentary premiered, and we had over 1,400 people at the Polk Theater who came to see our documentary. It's being sold across the nation. It's a huge, big deal. And I got what I wanted. My name was all over the place. And I was just like, I don't care. I want to go back now. And this past spring, this last spring, in February, I was like, okay, I have to go back to the Wajir. I had this chance with a missionary in Africa who's working with the AG World Missions. He had a door open. He said, you can come and work with me and do research on unreached people groups in Africa. And I would be under a stable organization, and I would have provision, and it would be someplace that would be easy to step into as a missionary. What a great place. Missionaries love those opportunities, those chances to be under a huge covering. But I wouldn't be able to work with this tribe. And it was just tearing me apart, because this was what, logically, this was what made sense, was working with this organization, with this missionary. But my heart was like, no, I just don't know what to do. I contacted a few authority figures in my life, and I asked them, what do you think I should do? And one wrote back to me, and he said, you never know what God's going to do. He said, just follow what your heart is telling you to do and just go. And I had no way of going. Tori's in the bush, so contacting him was impossible. And I was just like, I don't know how I'm going to get there. I don't know. I don't have any funds raised for it. I don't have contacts over there. I don't know how to get around. I don't know the language. I don't know how to get around in Tanzania. But I said, okay, I'm going to go. I started telling people, I'm going to be a missionary next fall in Tanzania to the Wajir tribe. I told this other missionary, I said, I can't go with you guys. I'm sorry. And I closed that door. I closed it completely to where it was like I couldn't go back and change my mind. And I was just, this leap of faith, it was freaking me out. I was sitting like, I can't believe I'm doing this. And everyone around me is like, I can't believe you're doing this. This is crazy. But literally the day after I completely closed these doors, Tori emails me out of the blue and says, I would like you to come and work with us in missions. I would like you to work in my ministry, and then you can work with the Wajir as well at the same time. And I was just, all this stuff, I can help you take care of all this stuff, and we will work with you. And I was just like, wow, I was in a place where God had to provide a place for me, and God provided the place for me right away. So that's what I'm doing. That's my next step. It's a little, I need you to pray for my sanity, actually, because this is really scary to me. So in June, I'm involved in the missions department at Southeastern, and in June, I'm leading a missions trip to Ecuador, and we're going to be gone from June 14th to June 28th. I'm leaving on June 29th for Tanzania. So literally, I think my layover in Tampa is like 12 hours, something like that. So I have 12 hours, and then I'm off to Tanzania. And my family leaves for England in 2 weeks. And they're going to be there all summer, so I have little time with my family now before I go over to Tanzania. And this is indefinite. I don't really have a plan to return from Tanzania. I'm jumping straight into full-time missions. So this is the biggest testimony I have to share. This last week, it hit me what was happening. That I was about to move overseas to Africa. I wasn't going somewhere comfortable, I was going to Africa. And I was so scared, and then suddenly I was just like, you know what, God, I don't want to go. All the gloss was gone. Everything that was good and fun about Tanzania was gone. I was like, if I'm sick in Tanzania, I'm not going to have my mom. She's not going to be there. And if I'm just homesick, what am I going to do? You can't just call someone in the middle of the night and just be like, Mom, I need to talk to you. It's like, you're so far away and the contact is so limited. I was just like, I don't want to go. And then this constant doubt, a very real spiritual attack on my life, this constant doubt, you're not ready for this. You are not ready for this. God, this constant nagging in myself. People keep saying, God's preparing you. God's getting ready to push you into something great. And I'm sitting like, I don't know if I can do this. I mean, I've never done missions before, and I'm about to go into full-time missions work. It's only ever been theory until now. And it's just been terrifying. And Tuesday morning, I was just lying in bed at 6 a.m. I was like, I don't want to do this. I want to cancel everything. I want to cancel all my plans. I don't want to do this. I mean, life would be so much easier if I just stayed here. And I opened my Bible, and the first thing I opened it to was Jeremiah 1. And God's calling Jeremiah, and he says, I'm just a youth. I'm not ready for this. And God says, don't say you are a youth, because you will go where I send you to go, and you will talk to the people I send you to talk to, and you won't be afraid, because I'll be there with you to deliver you. And suddenly I was just like, well, that can't be coincidence. And I was just, well, that must be it. I am with you always. I am with you is what he says. He says, fear not, because I am with you. Talk to these people, because I am with you. And up until now, for me, it's been, I'm going for God. But there's a huge difference between going for God and going with God. And this week it's been suddenly, I'm still struggling with it. I'm still at a place where I'm like, oh gosh, I don't really know if I want to go anymore. But I'm going anyways. Because I realize that's not what it's about. It's not about me. My flesh is weak. And there will be times when over there that I want to give up. But that's not what it's about. That's not why I'm going. I'm going because God called me to go. And even though I'm not ready, and that's okay that I'm not ready, because what God doesn't want is someone that's really talented. He doesn't want someone that's really strong. Because in the end, he can't use someone like that. He needs someone that's empty. Someone that can be used by him. And it astounds me how much he uses my weaknesses to propel things forward. Not my strengths. I like to think my strengths are so great, but it's not my strengths that are working right now. It's my weaknesses. Every point in my life where there's been a change has been because God has used my weakness to propel forward, and that's the most humbling thing. So as I go forward, I ask you guys to just pray with me. One point you may laugh at is I'd really like to pray for supernatural fluency in Swahili, because, and I'm not saying like I'm going to wake up tomorrow and be able to speak it fluently. I'm talking just like speed the process up. And I know that can happen because I have a friend who, he just started learning Spanish a year ago and he's totally fluent now. And I believe that's totally possible. So I'm asking for supernatural fluency in Swahili. That would help my my communications a great deal. I'm also asking for serious prayer about spiritual safety. Because so many doubts that have been just thrown onto me. And I know it's not because of me, it's a spiritual attack on me. And I know that it's not because I'm not strong enough spiritually to do this, it's because the devil's trying to stop me from going. And I just need serious prayer for that. And I also need prayer for the ministry that I go into. I'm going in to help found a nonprofit organization that I don't know what to do with that. I don't know how to do that. I mean, how many people can say they founded a nonprofit? I don't know. I don't know what to do or where to go next. And then this tribe, God has been throwing visions my way for this tribe. Visions, practical things. How do I meet these people's needs? But then also very, very spiritual and emotional needs that God's showing me how to meet visions that way. So that's what's going on. That's my testimony and where I'm going. So yeah, thank you very much.
Three different testimonies, three different stories. Seems to be a common denominator within all of those. I wrote on Facebook the other day, Holy Spirit, come and make me uncomfortable. And I got several messages of angry people asking me, what in the world are you talking about? Holy Spirit, make me uncomfortable. You guys have heard me say it before. I don't really think that we will ever know the Holy Spirit's true comfort unless we're uncomfortable. And, just awesome, awesome stories. I just wanted to read just five verses of scripture. You don't have to turn there. Luke 9, 22. We'll read verse 23. And he was saying to them all, if anyone wishes to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life shall lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake, he is the one who will save it. For what is a man profited if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, of him will the Son of Man be ashamed when he comes in his glory, in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. But I say to you truthfully, there are some of these standing here who shall not taste death until they see the kingdom of God. I just want to encourage you to be a voice of encouragement that what people are calling radical today is just simply biblical. It's really the world that we're living in. You hear, we're thinking radical testimonies, but when you line it up, this is just simply what we're being asked to do. And I pray that we would not only admire Alex and admire Chris and admire these women, but we would also seek in our own hearts about how we can too step out and say, Holy Spirit, make me uncomfortable. You guys know my testimony, maybe the last 5 years, I don't really know how to live other than uncomfortable. When I start to get comfortable, I just start doing crazy stuff. I give it away, I do something that, you know, drives my wife crazy, but I just want to get to that place where whether we have little or whether we have much, there's something to say for the desperation that's arising out of our hearts just to fulfill the will of God. There's a difference between knowing His will and then fulfilling it. It really, the gap between is that step of faith. So thank you for each and every one. Also as well, Taylor has been in the kids' church. They're putting icing on cookies and different things, and they're doing cookies for Kenya. I know that she's going to Kenya, so if you want to help her out, and I know there's some of the kids' church, there's a table out there, cookies for Kenya. I think it's like $3 for $3. But if you want to grab some, Alex, we're going to support you as well to Tanzania. I just feel led to do that too. And we already support Tori, but plenty of missions, plenty of things to give to. We'll be taking up a special missions offering the last Sunday of every month as well for those that we support. So stand with me. We're going to pray. We'd love for you to join us at Christina Park down the road for a cookout, games, just hang out, fellowship.
Do the, talk about the Beanies Mongolian, or sorry, the, what's it? Jay Burns fundraiser Tuesday. Can anybody hear me? I'll just yell it. Okay. on Tuesday, there's another fundraiser for the Mexico missions trip. If you go to and either one of the Jay Burns pizza places at any time of the day and tell them that you want your 20% of your check to go towards the Mexico missions team, it'll go to them. So there's a little promo. All right.
We're not really about missions here.
No.
Okay. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, Lord, to give your name glory, Lord, to continue to look at our lives and search deep within, Lord, and ask the hard questions, Lord, if there's anything in our lives this morning, Lord, that are hindering us, that are entangling us from pursuing and fulfilling the call. Lord, we just ask that you would teach us, Lord, how to make war on those things, how to remove those things. Lord, your word said that if any man would follow you, they must take up their cross. Lord, I just pray, Lord, that we would recognize even, Lord, your death as an invitation for us to die. Lord, your resurrection as an invitation for us to be resurrected with you. Lord, we just pray a blessing, Lord, upon all these trips, Lord, all these wonderful people that have stepped out, Lord. We just pray for the fellowship lunch today. Lord, we just ask that you would protect us, Lord. We just pray for deep intimacy from one another, toward one another. Lord, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Bless you guys. We will see.